Hello friends, in this session we are going to talk about time, speed and distance. Through the session we will understand its concept and the usage. So let's first of all understand what is the concept of time, speed and distance. So the first thing here is that this concept starts with the relation between speed, distance and time. So how do we define speed? Speed is actually distance traveled per unit time, and if we have to express it mathematically, we can say that speed is equal to distance divided by the time. So that means distance traveled divided by the time taken to travel that distance gives you the speed. Now looking at this formula, we can say that speed is directly proportional to the distance. And when we say directly proportional to distance, it means time remaining constant. What does that mean? It means that supposing we have to travel a distance d in a given time t, and now if we have to travel double the distance, say for example 2d, in the same time t we will have to double the speed also. So that means that there is a direct relation between speed and distance if the time remains constant. Similarly, if we look at this formula, we can also say that speed is inversely proportional to the time taken. Now what does that mean? This is also true if we take distance to be constant. So now if we travel a distance d in time t, now if we want to travel the same distance in double the time, the speed will have to reduce to half. Or if we have to cover the same distance in half the time, we will have to double the speed. So this is what gives you the relation between speed and distance and speed and time. And now what are the units of speed? We all know the units of distance are kilometer or meter, and distance and unit of time is, it could be seconds, it could be minutes, it could be hour. So the standard units of speed which are commonly used are kilometer per hour, which is written as kmph, and meter per second. So these are the two standard units which are used for speed, but of course there could be other units like kilometer per minute or meter per minute, things like that. So those could also be used. Now, because these are the two standard units that we generally use, let's understand the conversion between the two. If we take 1 kilometer per hour, this can be written as 1 kilometer divided by 1 hour. Now, if we change this 1 kilometer to 1000 meter and we write 1 hour as 3600 seconds and we cancel this out, so we get 1 kmph or 1 kilometer per hour is 5 by 18 meter per second. So this is the conversion between kilometer per hour and meter per second. So now let us understand, where is this concept used? We are saying time and distance concept, but this concept primarily uses speed. Without speed, this concept is not very useful. So this concept is actually time, speed and distance concept. So if we talk about the usage of this concept, we can divide it into two kinds. One is a very basic usage, just by looking at the formula, just by hearing this time, speed and distance concept, we know that the basic usage is we can find out the time taken to cover a distance. This can be found out if we have to if we are given the distance traveled and we know what is the speed of the travel, so we can find out the time taken to cover it. Or if we know that we have to reach a particular point, we reach a particular point in a given time and we travel it at a particular given speed, then we know how much distance has been traveled. So we can find out time taken, we can find out distance traveled, and if we know how much distance is covered in how much time, we can definitely find out what is the speed that has been that we're moving at. So these are the three basic things that we can find out, and these are obviously very useful in applications like, you know, where we need to do some planning, where we are traveling, we need to plan our journey. So we obviously take into criteria, we'll take into consideration the these kind of things, you know, how much distance we have to travel, how much time we can spend on the journey, and what is the kind of mode of communication that we take, because that will decide how much time. So these change the speed of travel and hence the time taken. So these are the kind of things which are very, very important in our daily use. But besides these, we have other uses which are not so basic. Where are they used? Now, supposing there are two objects which are moving towards each other, or maybe they are two objects which are just moving in the same direction. Now, if the speed of these two are different, they may cross each other at some point in time. So this time, speed and distance concept is used to plan traffic movements. Traffic movements to avoid collision. Now, if we know that there are two trains, this is specifically useful if we can think of the train scenario. So if there is a train which is going on one track and the other train coming, so the traffic is planned in such a way, we know that the speed of these two trains is so much, and how do we make sure that they cross each other at a platform where they can change tracks so we can avoid collision. So these kind of traffic movements are planned based on this concept. Then there are other things like circular motion. So now if we have two objects moving in circular motion, it could be like satellites if we can think of that, or maybe, you know, if we have a racetrack and two people are racing, but they're racing in the opposite directions, how many times will they cross, at what distance will they cross? Similar would be the case for satellites. This is again, we again use the concept of time, speed and distance. And another thing which is very, very commonly used is upstream, downstream and upstream motion. Now supposing we go to a place and then we come back. So now we normally see that sometimes going may take more time as compared to coming back, or sometimes going may take lesser time as compared to coming back, and that could be because of the direction in which we are moving with respect to wind or water. So now in those cases, if we are moving against the wind or if we are moving with the wind, our speeds would be different. So again, you know, this is the concept of time, speed and distance, which is used in these kind of motions also. And again, these will help plan the movements, help plan the journeys, help plan the time taken for all those things. So this is where these concepts are very, very commonly used, very, very useful. So now let's understand, what do we mean by average speed? Now supposing we are going from one place to another. Now I'm going from A to B. Now there is a point C in between. From A to C, I travel at a speed S1. From C to B, I travel at another speed S2. Now, why would I change my speed? It could be either because of the change in the vehicle that I'm using for traveling. It could be because of the terrain of the road. I am moving in plains from A to C, and from C to B I move to hills, or any other reason, right? So there could be maybe, you know, if first somebody else is driving and then somebody else drives, so they may have their own speed. So these kind of things change, and hence I travel my journey at two different speeds. Now, how do we find out? How do I get the average speed? So to understand that, let's first understand what do we mean by average speed. Average speed is the total distance traveled divided by the total time taken. This is average speed. Right? So when I say that I am moving at a speed S1 here and a speed S2 here, that means from A to C, I covered this distance AC in a given time T1, which gives me the speed of S1, whereas from C to B, I moved at a different speed. I covered this some distance D2 in a different time T2, which gives me this speed. Now, how do we find out? How do I find out what is my average speed through the journey A to B? We know if we have to find out average of numbers, and we'll say two numbers here, we know that the method is N1 plus N2 by 2. So this is how we find out the average of two numbers. Can we use this for speed? Can we use the same approach? S1 plus S2 by 2 gives me the average speed from A to B. Let's see. Let's understand that with the help of an example. Now, if I have this person P, traveling 2 kilometer distance at the rate of 2 kilometer per hour, and the same person travels the next 2 kilometer at the rate of 4 kmph. So if we find out, so this is S1 and this is S2. Now if I were to find out the average speed by just adding and dividing by 2, I will get 2 plus 4 by 2, which gives me 3 kmph, right? So this should be the average speed. Now let's see how much distance we have covered. We've covered a total of 4 kilometers, and we know by this average speed that it is 3 kilometers per hour. So the time taken would be 4 divided by 3 hours. While from the original data, we know that initial 2 kilometer at 2 kilometer per hour takes 1 hour, and another 2 kilometer at 4 kilometer per hour takes 0.5 hours. So we know that from the original data, the time taken is coming out to be 1.5 hours, which is definitely different from 4.3 hours. So that means, that clearly means that this method is definitely wrong. This is not how we'll calculate our average speed. So now let's see what is the way to find it out then. So as we said, average speed is, so I'll say average speed is equal to, I'll write it out again, total distance divide by total time taken, right? So what is the logic that we have to apply? Again, taking the same example, we have position A, we have position B, and in between position C, speed S1 here and speed S2 here. So the logic to be used here is that we need to find out the complete distance from A to B. So we find out the total distance first, and then we find out the total time taken from point A to B. So if we look at the previous example where 2 kilometer is traveled at 2 kilometer per hour and the next 2 kilometer traveled at 4 kilometer per hour, so we will not directly deal with the speed. We will first find out how much is the total distance traveled in both the cases together. So we know that it is 2 plus 2, 4. And then we'll find out how much is the time taken. So here we know the time taken is 1 hour. Here the time taken is 0.5 hour. So we'll get 1.5 here. Right? So this is how this will give me the average speed. So now we'll find out the formula for calculating average speed if the two speeds are given, which are two speeds and the distance corresponding to each speed is given to us, then how do we find out the average speed? So now let's first of all assume that distance d1 is covered at speed s1 and distance d2 is covered at speed s2. Now if we are to find out total distance, we clearly know this is equal to d1 plus d2. Now let's understand the time taken. Let's call it t1 to travel d1. That will be given by d1 by s1. Similarly, time taken t2 to travel d2 will be given by d2 by s2, because he traveled distance d2 at a speed of s2. So now the total time, which is t1 plus t2, will be given by d1 by s1 plus d2 by s2. Now if I have to find out the average speed, I know it is given by total distance traveled divided by total time taken. So the total distance is d1 plus d2, this divide by d1 by s1 plus d2 by s2, this much kilometer per hour, assuming this is kilometer per hour for both the speeds and d1 and d2 are given in kilometers. If this is not the case, then we'll need to change the, we'll need to use the conversion of the units so that all the units are taken in a similar fashion. So this gives us the formula for calculating the average speed. Now this can be extrapolated if instead of just two speeds and two distances, if we were given three or maybe five, we can again do that. D1 plus D2 plus D3 plus D4 plus D5 divide by, again the same thing, D1 by S1 plus D2 by S2 plus so on till D5 by S5. So this is how we'll find out the average speed. Now let's take a special case. If we say half journey, and here we say half journey is D, is covered at speed S1. Second half, which is again D because it is half, is covered at S2. Now if we have to find out the average speed, the total distance is 2D, D plus D, divided by D by S1 plus D by S2. Now we can say it becomes 2D by D. We can take out D common from the denominator and we cancel out these two. So we get 2S1 S2 divided by S1 plus S2. So this is the formula for calculating the average speed if half of the journey is covered at one speed and half of the journey is covered at the other speed. So if we're given the two speeds and we're told that half the journey is at this speed and the other half is at this speed, we can just use this formula to find out the average speed of the journey. Now let's take another special case. If we are saying half the time, let's take it to be t, we travel at a speed s1. Second half time, again t, because half time is covered at the speed s2. Now if we have to find out what is the average speed, let's find out the distance traveled in first half, distance d1, which will be given by s1 into t. The distance traveled in the second half time, let's call it d2, will be given by s2 t, right? So if we have to find out the average speed, which we write as SAV, that is equal to total distance, which is d1 plus d2. So we can say s1 t plus s2 t divided by the total time taken, which is t plus t, or we can write it as 2t. Now if we take out 2 common from here, and we can say t into s1 plus s2 divided by 2, t and t cancels, so this is given by s1 plus s2 by 2. So this is the formula which we talked about in the very beginning of the session, that the way we find out the average of the numbers, can we use that formula for finding out the average speed. This can be used only in a very specific case where half the time we travel at speed s1 and the other half time we travel at s2. So this formula can only be used in this special case. So now friends, let's understand what is relative speed. Now if there are two objects and these don't necessarily have to be objects, these could be two people, two animals, trains, it could be anything. So just to starting, we are taking two objects here. If two objects are there, they may be moving, they may be stationary, relative speed is the speed of one object with respect to the other object, right? So this is the relative speed. Now let's say A is moving with the speed v1 and B is moving with the speed v2. Now here we've shown that these are moving in the same direction. Now in this case, if they are moving in the same direction, the relative speed will be given by v1 minus v2, and we can say mod of this, which would mean we'll only take the value of this difference, because v1 could be higher than v2 or v2 could be higher than v1. So the difference between the two will be the relative speed if both of them are moving in the same direction. Let's take an example here. Now supposing there is a train which is moving and there's a person sitting on the train, sitting in the train, and he's moving with the train. Now the velocity of the speed of the train is also v1, and the speed of the object is the person sitting is also v2. The person is sitting in the train. So what is the relative speed between the of the train with respect to the person? It'll be v1 minus v2, which is 0. And that is why we see that the person will not feel that the train is moving, because both are moving at the same speed, right? So similarly, if a person is running fast and the other person is moving slower, but they are both moving in the same direction, the difference between the two will be their relative speed. But if we take an example of these two moving in different direction, it could be they're moving towards each other, or it could be both moving away from each other, but they're moving in opposite directions. Now in this case, relative speed is given as the sum of the two speeds, Why? We can just see, you know, if it is this person A who is moving here, and this is the person B who is moving towards A. Now both are moving towards each other. They will seem to come closer to each other much faster than their individual speeds. Why? Because the relative speed, both of them are moving. So their relative speed becomes the sum of the two. Similarly, if A is moving away from B and B is also moving away from A, now the rate at which they will move farther will also be the sum of the two speeds, because both are moving away. So these are the two formulas for the relative speed. If the two objects are moving towards each other, then it is v1 plus v2, or if both of them are moving away from each other, then also it is v1 plus v2. But if both of them are moving in the same direction, then it is given by v1 minus v2. So now let's take a specific case of relative speed. If two objects, let's take these two objects A and B, they start from the point A and B with a speed v1 and v2. Okay, respectively, and after they cross each other. So at this point, at some point, say C, A will continue to move towards B and B will continue to move towards A. So they will cross each other at this point. If the time taken to reach point B is given by A and to reach. So we are saying the person who was moving from A to B, he takes point A, he takes time A, and time taken to reach point A is B after they cross. This is after they cross. Then the time taken is A and B respectively. Then the ratio of their speeds which is v1 by v2 is given by b by a square root. Now how do we come to this? Let's understand. Now let's see, let's assume that they cross the point C. They cross the point C, which is at a distance x from A, and we take the total distance to be D. So the point C is D minus X away from B. Right? So the time taken by A to reach point C is X by V1. And this is same as the time taken by B to reach point C. Why? Because they are crossing each other at that point. So that would mean D minus X by V2. So these are equal. Now this implies V1 by V2 is equal to X divided by D minus X. Right? So this is the first equation that we get. Now we also know that from C to B, time taken is A. From C to B, by the object which was at A, which is moving at a velocity of v1, the time taken is A. So we can say it has to now travel at distance d minus x divided by v1. It is still continuing. This is still continuing at the v1 speed. This is equal to A. And similarly, for the object which was running from B to A, it has to cover a distance x, right, at a speed v2. This is equal to B. So from this, we can say v1 by V2. We can actually say d minus x by a is equal to V1 and x by b is equal to V2. So we can say V1 by V2 will be given by d minus x by a divide by x by b. So we can say divide by b by x, right? So V1 by V2, now this is the second equation. We put this value from 1 into this. We can say x by d minus x is V1 by V2. So we will replace this. This becomes b by a into. Now this x by d minus x will be replaced by V2 by V1. This is V1 by V2 is equal to b by a into V2 by V1. So from this we can simplify to get, if we just take V1, we cross multiply this and this, we get V1 square by V2 square is equal to b by a, and V1 by V2 is equal to b by a square root. So this is the ratio of the speeds if this data is given to us. So this is a very special case of relative speed. This is how we find out the relation between the two speeds. So friends, you can visit us at our Cool Smart Learning website and subscribe to our YouTube channel to get updates on this.